Yoga Vasistha, Part 21 by Swami Suryadevananda. Salutations to that reality in which all the elements and all the animate and inanimate beings shine as if they have an independent existence, and in which they exist for a time and into which they merge. Salutations to that consciousness which is the source of the apparently distinct threefold divisions of knower, knowledge and known, seer, sight and seen, doer, doing and deed. Salutations to that bliss absolute, the ocean of bliss, which is the life of all beings, whose happiness and unfoldment is derived from the shower of spray from that ocean of bliss. The last time, we talked about the fifth of the seven states or planes of wisdom, Asamshakti. Asamshakti is natural and total non-attachment or freedom. Towards this, we talked about four major points. Total non-attachment or freedom and conviction in the nature of truth happen together. Two, the state of non-attachment or freedom is Asamshakti. Three, perception of the world gives way to the feeling of being. And four, though engaged in worldly activities, one is established in an inner vision of non-duality. Today, let's briefly look into Vasistha's sixth and seventh states or planes of wisdom. The last two are Padartha Bhavini, or natural cessation of objectivity, and the seventh, Turiya, or liberated while being. My friends, the reason I said briefly is that there's not much to be said about these states, as when you ascend in the spiritual life, the gap between knower, known, and knowing melt, and all the particularities also fade. And since there aren't that many particularities and they start fading, there is not so much to talk about. A similar thought has also been expressed in the great Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, when the great sage Yajnavalkya says to Maitreya, "There are no means or instruments to illumine the self, as the self illumines all the modifications of the intellect and remains as their witness." By what means can you know the self which shines by its own light? This perhaps is one of the greatest echoes of the great Brihadaranyaka Upanishad by the great sage Yajnavalkya. A similar theme comes to mind as we talk about things out here. But we have to still say something as we cover these important teachings. But let us do so and temper it with this understanding that as one climbs the ladder of yoga, less is more. Greetings. Let us start with the sixth of these seven states, and we have the last two to cover. The sixth one is Padartha Bhavini, or the natural cessation of objectivity. This feeling that that is something and this I am, and therefore that is an object to me, that feeling is overcome. This word Padartha Bhavini is probably broken down into Pada, Artha and Bhavini, three words that come together to form Padartha Bhavini. Pada is a thing or an object. Artha is a meaning and Bhavini is a feeling towards it. Therefore, it is a feeling that we have that this is something and this I am, and there is a difference between me and that something. This is overcome. So, a closer examination of all this is that when we stay witness to all the mind's notions, we realize that what we consider as an object is a notion within our own self. And these notions are but our reactions to things. They rise and fall naturally within the mind, within consciousness, and we are not generally conscious. We generally associate a thing or an object as purely outside, and the reactions are tied to that object and not tied to us. We don't generally consider. Therefore, if we say it's not a good thing, it's a thing that is not good, we never stop to consider that that not good is not part of the thing, but it is part of our reaction. It is our reaction to that thing. And therefore, the not good or good or I like or I dislike, this is a thing, my friends, that we have generally ascribed completely to the objects. And when we talk about objects, we are not just talking about things. We're talking about people, conditions, and things, anything external. And this is where watching the mind in meditation becomes instrumental, becomes key. That mind has to be relentlessly watched. So in our normal day-to-day lives, there is a thinning of this feeling of objectivity. We see the object, or we see whatever is out there, and we are also aware of our reactions to it. Instantly, or at that moment, real time, lifetime, we are aware that these reactions do not belong to the object, but they are part of our mind's reactions. They are our mind's reactions to them. When we realize that, the force of this attitude that we have towards objects starts thinning down because of disuse. We are not injecting it with any more value, and therefore that starts thinning down. The object stands as it is, and there isn't a feeling of like and dislike and preference and all of that that happens to the object. The mind becomes very, very stable. Reactions are a sort of getting caught up in the notions we have about objects. And my friends, this is a habit and nothing else. All our reactions towards people, things, and conditions are a habit. And this habit can be let go whenever you sincerely wish to do so. You have to be wholeheartedly on board, because it takes effort from us, not because of anything else, but because we are fighting within our own selves. Habit is you in the past, and aspiration is you in the present for a better future. These two collide, and in this collision, it seems like there is struggle. But this struggle, my friends, is clearly proportional to the level of conviction that you muster in your heart to overcome conditioning. And this is what it comes down to. Yoga is the system by and means at the same time, two of them, the system and means of disentanglement from habit, and at the same time an abidance in witness consciousness, the self, or the truth. So, an disentanglement from habit on one hand, and an abidance in the truth on the other. These two happen together. This is one of the definitions, or a clear definition of yoga. Just because we perceive something or someone doesn't mean that that person is external, out there, separate, or other. This is the important point. We'll still have perception, and it will still seem like it's out there. But we will know all the time that that out there notion may not be true wholeheartedly, because even the idea of the person rises within our own consciousness. The idea, or you can call it realization, that this person is out there, that notion arises within me. If I am seeing you, for instance, right now, that notion that I am seeing you and you are out there, where does that notion arise? That notion arises within me. That notion does not arise in out there. And this is something that we overlook completely, and this is something that Yoga Vasistha asks us to examine. When this truth lodges deeply in the heart, one starts rejoicing in the self. All these problems that we have, difficulties and confusion that's out there, is let go. When we let go of this out there business, then one rejoices in the self, and the perception of duality and diversity ceases. When duality and diversity are not entertained as a reality, they lose their force. It may still seem, it may still seem like there is out there and there is another. But let it seem, and let us not take that to be reality, because that seeming, as we have discussed, arises within us. The notion of externality, the notion of objectivity, the notion of out there, that person or this thing is out there. Where does that notion arise? In me. Whatever I know about out there arises in me. Then how am I so sure of out there as a reality? And when out there or other is not a reality, how is it justified for me to have all these reactions to something that arises within me? Isn't that a natural, a formula for chaos? I will be reacting to myself. And when I react to myself, there's going to be turmoil. This is at the heart of all of the problems that we experience in life. And this has to be overcome. And it is towards this that the yoga of Vasistha girds up its loins and talks about these tremendous things. The effort made at the inspiration of others bears fruition in direct spiritual experience. All the things that we have heard, when we put them to practice, they bear fruit. So the man of wisdom, the one who has come to know this directly, not theoretically, but sitting and with hours and hours and time of practice, not just on the mat, but in life too, the man of wisdom clearly realizes that all this out there business is in fact in here. When that is realized, the out there is let go. When the out there-ness is let go, the reactions that one has towards things is also let go at the same time. When both these are let go, there is tremendous peace, there is calm. And that person is called a man of wisdom because he now knows. This man of wisdom is aware of the objects as objects only if he feels compelled to do so. Now, what does this mean? That he will not know there is a tree out there, there is something out there? No, there may be a tree, but that feeling that that tree is out there and other, that notion doesn't enter his mind. And so he deals with things not apart, as not apart from his own self. That is a very big difference. Then there is this is a natural and spontaneous cessation of objectivity, that out there-ness. And this is called Padartha Bhavini, and this is the sixth state. So when this happens, my friend, mental activity is greatly diminished, greatly decreased, and even concepts such as unity and diversity do not arise. All bonds are severed. What can you be bound to when there is nothing out there? We are not bound to ourselves. So when we don't see anything as out there or other, all bonds and all our reaction towards things are also let go at the same time. Abiding in this state and dwelling in this state, one gradually reaches the state that is called liberated in embodiment, or Jivan Mukta. A Jivan Mukta, or an embodied person who's still living, lives a normal life, but in an extraordinary way. Like a house whose swing doors open and close naturally as the wind blows. He does things naturally, does what needs to be done, as it needs to be done, when it needs to be done, how it needs to be done, but without any notions these hang-ups and notions of what's in it for me, and how will it work out, and how will it be taken, and what will happen next. All of those, that is the tension in our lives. Events and what we need to do about them are not the tension in our life. They are great joy. This person, you can say, has attained something, but in another sense you can say that he has attained nothing. As what can you call? Can you call attaining your true nature something? Not really. Now, my friends, we come to the last state or plane of wisdom, Turiya. And there is not much to be said, as we discussed earlier, as we climb up the rung of the Yoga Vasishtha's ascent or ladder. Turiya is liberated while living. This is something one has to know, each one for himself. But a few words can be said. There is no support after one crosses Padartha Bhavani, this natural feeling of objectivity. When that is overcome, objectivity is overcome. From that point on, there is no other support. There is no other, there is no outside. Just persistent practice, persistent wholehearted practice. Gradually, the vision of division ceases. Even the division between us and our notions that we have in our mind. When these notions are not entertained, the notions lose their momentum and they gradually merge back in consciousness. All division ceases, all otherness ceases completely, and one is gradually established in that one homogeneous state of oneness or unconditioned being. At that point, when self-knowledge stands by itself or consciousness stands by itself, self-knowledge is spontaneous, natural, and therefore unbroken. That state is known as Turiya, or liberated while living. In that state, they say, body consciousness is completely overcome, because even the body that is considered other, or my body, or I am feeling this pain, or I, when all the divisions, all, are overcome, body consciousness is also overcome. And in this state, the boundary of becoming is crossed over, and one enters a realm or abides in true being. One is still aware of the body, but does not mistake the body as the sense of I or sense of self. This is the distinguishing feature. And when one reaches this stage, one goes over sorrow permanently. Not because one enters some kind of mystical state, but my friends, let's take our minds all the way back to the beginning. All our sorrow, all our grief, all our tensions, all our confusion, all of that, all of the whole bag, bucket load of it. What is it because? It is because of something or someone or some condition. But the word externality, some, has to be there. When that someness or otherness is overcome completely, what can there be confusion towards and by whom? Let us briefly summarize the seven states or planes of wisdom that we have covered in five videos earlier and the last two in this one today. So we look at all seven of them together. One, shubicha, or a noble wish. When one clearly sees the danger in leading an unexamined life, one has given up any and all craving for pleasure as well, and one aspires for what is good and what is lasting. And this is known as a noble wish or shubicha. Two, vicharana, or direct and steady observation of the mind. When the mind is directly observed without remission, it is also called the practice of inquiry and direct observation into the nature of reality, or vicharana. 3. Tanumanasi or Tanumanasa, or the thinned and weakened mind. When there arises a disinterestedness in the pleasures of the senses, and my friends, we are not talking about aversion, but we are talking about disinterestedness. Mark the difference in that. It is true non-attachment based on intelligent discrimination. The mind is weakened and it becomes subtle and transparent, or tanumanasi. 4. Sattvapatti, or natural turning away from sense pleasure and dwelling in truth. When the first three are sincerely practiced, there arises in the seeker a natural turning away from sense pleasure, and at the same time, a natural dwelling or abiding in the truth. This results in purity or sattva in the heart and is called sattvapatti. Asamshakti, or natural and total non-attachment or freedom. When the last four are sincerely practiced, there is total non-attachment or freedom, and at the same time, a conviction in the nature of truth. There is great inner peace and joy, which is independent of external objects and internal mental states. My friends, this is a very important thing, because generally our joy, and if you call it non-joy, are all based upon external things, people and conditions. To know a joy that is not based on anything other or out is a tremendous thing. This state of non-attachment or freedom is Asamshakti. 6. Padartha Bhavini, or natural cessation of objectivity. When one rejoices in one's own self, the perception of duality and diversity ceases, and the efforts that one made at the inspiration of others bears fruit in direct spiritual experience. The man of wisdom is aware of objects only if and when he feels compelled to do so. This natural and spontaneous cessation of objectivity is called Padartha Bhavini. And last of all, Turiya, or liberated while living. Coming to this stage, there is no other support. By persistent practice, the vision of division ceases, and one is fully established in one's own unconditioned being. Self-knowledge is spontaneous, natural, and unbroken. That state is known as liberated even while living, or Turiya. My friends, we've covered in detail, some detail, the seven states or planes of wisdom of the great sage Vasistha. We are gradually coming towards the end of this series. Next time, we take up a very interesting story or analogy called The Dreadful Elephant in the Forest of Samsara. Friends, thank you for joining me today. To download this video, its audio or PDF handout, kindly visit suryadevananda.org. Thank you.